Today we will first consider transformation of strain epsilon ij from one system of coordinates to another system of coordinates. Let us consider that epsilon ij is defined in the system x, y, z, and we want to define this in a new system, let us say as epsilon m n, which is now given by the set x z, y z and z, x dash, y dash and z dash. Since epsilon I j is a second rank tensor, we can make use of the transformation rules for second rank tensor. You have already been acquainted with the transformation of stresses sigma I j given in a system x y z to sigma m n, which is to be defined in a system x dash y dash z dash. So, we directly adopt the transformation rules. Let us just consider that the direction cosines of the three coordinates are given by epsilon I j with respect to the old coordinates. Then we can write that epsilon m n in the new system is nothing but L m I L n j sigma epsilon epsilon I j. So, this is defined in the new coordinates and this is given in the old coordinates, and these are the direction cosines of the new coordinates. So, these are the direction cosines of new coordinates. So, it is a relationship which is very similar to that of transformation of sigma ij. This is the advantage that if we work in tensor, irrespective of the field of application, so long as the rank of the tensor is the same, we can make use of the same rule for transformation. Now, we would like to consider definition of strains in polar coordinates. You have considered the definition of strains in rectangular coordinates. You will find that when you are dealing with geometries which are having circular configuration, therein you will find advantage working in strains defined in polar coordinates. So, when a circular disk is loaded by external loading, it is undergoing deformation, and you will find that any point on the disk is going to have some displacement in the radial direction and some displacement in the tangential direction. So, we will have two components of displacement in two dimensions. One is u, which is in the radial direction, and v is the displacement in the tangential directions, and you must appreciate that this u is going to be now a function of radial position and also the angular disposition of the point. So, if we consider this as the reference, with respect to this reference we can define a point by the angle theta. So, this is going to be, therefore, the point is going to be defined with respect to coordinates r theta. So, therefore, u is going to be a function of r theta. Similarly, v is also going to be a function of r and theta. Now, to find out the strains, let us consider deformation of a element of the body upon loading. Let us consider that we have one element which is shown here. Let us consider an element which is defined by this radial dimension delta r and the angular disposition delta theta. So, let us consider that this particular element is spanning at an angle of delta theta. So, this is the angle delta theta, and let us take this as the reference direction, and this angle is equal to, let us say, theta, and this is the center of the coordinate. Now, let us name the element as A, B, C and D. So, this is the element. Now, upon loading, this particular element is going to take up displaced position. Let us draw the displaced position to a larger scale. So, this is the displaced position. Let us say that this is the position of A. Let us say that this is new position of A and it is A dash. Similarly, new position of B is B dash, new position of D is D dash, and the new position of C is C dash. Now, the displacement that A has undergone in the radial direction is this much. Let us say that this is the displacement u, and the tangential displacement, which is exactly in the orthogonal direction, this is equal to v. The point B has undergone a displacement in the radial direction of this magnitude, and it is indicated by BB1 here, and it has undergone a tangential displacement of this magnitude, which is B1 to B dash. Now, if I consider that this u and v are continuous functions of r and theta, okay. So, u and v are continuous functions of r and theta over the domain of the body. We can consider this distance AB to be given by, it is a small distance, it is given by delta r, and let us also consider that these distance of point O, point A from the center O is equal to r. Now, if we consider that this point B is located at a small distance from A, we can find out the displacement in the radial direction of B by Taylor series expansion. So, we can write displacement of B as u plus delta u delta r multiplied by delta r. So, therefore, that is the displacement of b in the radial direction. Similarly, the displacement b 1 b dash, which is in the theta direction, we consider this to be theta direction, that can also be now, since this is v, we can now consider change of v with distance a b, and it is going to be therefore v plus delta v delta r multiplied by delta r. If you now consider the point C, it has some movement in the tangential direction, so which is this, let us say this is C C 1, and we can write this distance C C 1 as v plus rate of change of v with respect to theta, so therefore, delta v delta theta, and we have moved a distance of delta theta, so therefore, delta v delta theta into delta theta, that will give us this displacement. Similarly, it has moved a distance in the radial direction, which is this one, and c 1 c dash, we can again write in terms of the displacement in the radial direction of the point A, and therefore, this distance is going to be u plus delta u delta theta multiplied by delta theta. So, this is what is the displacement in the radial direction of the point C. Now, let us do some construction. Let us represent this point as A 1, and then we try to draw an arc here passing through the point A dash. So, with center O, we draw an arc passing through the point A dash. Let us consider that the intersection of C 1 C dash here is C 2, and similarly, we try to draw a line joining O 2 A dash. That makes an angle of, let us say, delta, and now we extend this line here. Let us say the intersection of this radial line with B 1 B dash is B 3. We draw a line parallel to A 1 B 1, which is this one. Let us say that that intersect B 1 B dash at point B 2. So, therefore, this angle is, since this is parallel to this, therefore, this angle is equal to this angle, and therefore, that is equal to delta. We also indicate the angle, approximate angle between this A dash B dash and A dash B 3 is equal to gamma 1, and similarly, the angle made by the direction A dash C dash with this arc is equal to gamma 2. With this, we are ready to define the strains. So, if we now consider the strain in the radial direction, which is represented as epsilon r, that is equal to limit delta r tending to 0, length of this element a b tending to 0, change in the length of AB divided by length of AB. Now, I would like you to note that point A has moved by u and point B has moved by u plus delta u delta r delta r. So, therefore, the net stretching has been this distance minus this. So, therefore, it is delta u delta r delta r. Therefore, this change in length of AB is nothing but this distance minus this u. So, therefore, that will be delta u delta r delta r. So, we can now write limit delta r tending to 0 delta u delta r delta r, and length of AB is nothing but delta r. So, therefore, this strain in the radial direction is given by delta u delta r, which is the partial derivative of radial displacement with respect to r. Similarly, if we consider epsilon theta is defined as the change in the length of AC divided by the original length of AC as the angle delta theta tends to 0. So, therefore, this is delta theta tending to 0 change of AC divided by length of AC. Now, if I just consider that AC is not moving in the radial direction at all, it has remained in the same radial disposition and it has moved in the tangential direction only, then you see that point A has moved in the tangential direction by v, and this point C has moved by v plus delta v delta theta del theta, and therefore, the net movement has been this total minus v, therefore, that is delta v delta theta del theta. So, that is one part which comes up from the tangential displacement of AC in the tangential direction only. Now, if you consider AC does not move in the tangential direction, it simply moves in the radial direction. So, it has moved from position AC to the position, let us say, this to this. So, therefore, it has moved from this position to this position. The length AC was initially, AC was, that is nothing but r into delta theta. Now, if it moves to this position A 1 to this, then in that case its length is going to change by u plus r delta theta. So, therefore, there will be a change of magnitude equal to r plus u delta theta minus r delta theta. So, therefore, that will be u delta theta. So, therefore, you find that the contributions here in this case is going to be like this. Change in length of AC will be first of all of magnitude delta v delta theta plus the contribution due to the change in position in the radial direction is u delta theta, and the original length is nothing but r delta theta. So, we find now the strain is given by u by r plus 1 by r delta v delta theta. So, therefore, the circumferential strain or tangential strain is u by r plus 1 by r delta v delta theta. Now, we have to consider the shear strain. Let us consider now shear strain, which will be indicated as gamma r theta, and this is given by limit delta r tending to 0 delta theta tending to 0 change in the angle between the two directions, orthogonal directions AC and AB. So, therefore, that is nothing but change in the angle, change in angle CAB. Now, C has taken up position C dash, B has taken up position B dash, and A has taken up position A dash. So, therefore, the angle change is given by here the local orthogonal directions. Please note that the local orthogonal directions here, this is the radial directions passing through A dash, and this is the tangential direction passing through A dash. So, therefore, the change in angle is nothing but this angle gamma 1 plus gamma 2. So, therefore, this is nothing but limit delta r tending to 0 delta theta tending to 0 gamma 1 plus gamma 2. Now, I would like you to see this, that this angle gamma 2 is nothing but approximately this distance divided by AC approximately, because we approximate A dash C 2 by AC. Therefore, this distance is nothing but, since this distance is equal to u 1, therefore, this distance is nothing but u plus delta u delta theta multiplied by delta theta minus u. So, therefore, this distance is nothing but this magnitude. So, therefore, this is given by only this quantity, and this distance AC is r theta. So, therefore, this gamma 2 we can write gamma 2 as 1 by r delta theta multiplied by delta u delta theta del theta. And let us now see what is gamma 1. So, gamma 1 is nothing but, if we consider this total angle gamma 1 plus delta, that is nothing but this b 1 b 2 minus b 1, I am sorry, this angle gamma plus delta is given by this distance b 2 b dash divided by this distance. Now, if you look into that, this b 1 b 2 is nothing but v, and this total distance, we had got this total distance as v plus delta v delta r del r. So, therefore, this total distance is nothing but given by this quantity. So, if we subtract v, therefore, this distance here is going to be given by this magnitude. So, therefore, delta v delta r is this distance, and this a 1 b 2 can be approximated by a b, which is delta r. So, therefore, this angle gamma plus gamma 1 plus delta is nothing but it is approximately equal to b 2 b dash divided by AB, and this is equal to, since B to B dash is equal to delta V delta R, we can approximate this by delta R. So, therefore, it is going to be delta V delta R. Now, angle delta is equal to this angle. If we consider that this distance OA is equal to R, then this angle is approximately equal to this distance divided by OA, which is going to be V by R. So, therefore, delta is equal to V by R. So, we have now delta is equal to V by R. So, finally, we have gamma 1 is equal to delta V delta R minus V by R. So, we can now substitute the value in the expression of gamma R theta. So, therefore, now we have gamma R theta is equal to, it is limit delta R tending to 0 delta theta tending to 0, gamma 2 is nothing but 1 by R delta u delta theta, and gamma 1 is nothing but delta V delta R minus V by R. So, that is nothing but 1 by R delta u delta theta plus delta V delta R minus V by R. So, therefore, you find that the three components of strain in polar coordinates are here: epsilon r is delta u delta r, epsilon theta is u by r plus 1 by r delta v delta theta, and gamma r theta is nothing but 1 by r delta u delta theta delta v delta r minus v by r. Let us now consider equilibrium equations in two dimensional rectangular coordinates. If you just consider a two dimensional object like this, subjected to loading at its boundary, it can also have load at internal points, then under the action of this loading, stresses are going to develop at each and every point of the body, and we will have some constraint or some relations satisfied by the stresses at each and every point of the body. We would like to find out them, and they are nothing but the equilibrium equations. We just concentrate on an element which is of very small dimension, let us say it is of dimension delta x by delta y. And let us consider that the thickness of this body is uniform, and that thickness in the z direction, thickness let us say t, that is thickness in the z direction. Now, if I try to draw this element to a larger scale, let us show it like this. So, therefore, this is delta y, this is delta x. Now, the stresses that are going to come up on this face, let us say that the stress in the, this is nothing but minus x face. So, therefore, this is minus the stress in the x direction is sigma x, and the that is the normal stress, and the stress which is acting parallel to the face is nothing but tau xy. Similarly, let us say that the stress acting on this face is nothing but sigma y, and the shear stress on this face is equal to tau y x. The stresses and strains are continuous functions since the body is continuous. So, if we want to represent the stress on the other face, which is parallel to this, but which is at a distance of delta x, we can make use of the Taylor series expansion, and we can write the stress on this face in the normal direction to be as sigma x plus delta sigma x delta x delta x. So, therefore, that is the normal stress. Similarly, the shear stress acting on this face is going to be tau xy plus delta tau xy delta x multiplied by delta x. Again, it is the Taylor series expansion of this tau xy, and we have got this stress. If we consider the normal stress on this face, that is obtainable again from the normal stress here, and it is changing in the y direction. So, therefore, we can write now this is sigma y plus delta sigma y delta y into delta y, and the shear stress which is acting here, we can indicate that thing in terms of this tau y x, and this is tau y x plus delta tau y x delta y multiplied by delta y. So, this is the shear stress. Now, the body can be also subjected to forces at internal points. One of the type of force that is commonly faced is the body force. We indicate that as body force. Examples like gravity forces, centrifugal forces. So, if the stresses are to be calculated under the action of the body forces, then we must try to bring in those type of forces at each and every point of the body. Or if you are interested in calculating the stresses under the action of rotation of the body, then we must bring in the inertia forces. These are all treated as body forces, so which depends only on the volume. So, therefore, we call these things as body forces. So, if we consider that the body force acting at this point per unit volume in the x direction by capital X, and the body force per unit volume acting in the y direction as capital Y. So, this is the this is the element and the forces that are acting on the element on its boundaries. Since the body is in equilibrium, under the action of the external forces and also the body forces, each and every point of the body must also be in equilibrium, and therefore, this element which is which is subjected to forces at its boundary like this, and at the same time it is subjected to forces x and y, we must have this particular element in equilibrium under the action of all these forces. So, by the consideration of such equilibrium, whatever equations we get are nothing but equilibrium equations. Let us now consider the equilibrium in the x direction. So, sum of the forces in the x direction must be equal to 0. What are the stresses that contribute to the forces in the x direction? You have this component of stress this component of stress, then these two shear components, this one and this one, they are going to contribute to the forces in the x direction. On top of that, you are also going to have this force contributing to the force in the x directions. Now, the force arising out of this stress acting on this space, whose area is nothing but delta y multiplied by t. So, therefore, the force here is nothing but sigma x plus delta x multiplied by sigma y into delta t. And the force which is arising out of this stress sigma x is nothing but sigma x into delta y into t. So, therefore, the net force which is coming out from these two components in the x direction is going to be delta sigma x delta x delta x multiplied by delta y into delta t. And since delta y x into delta y into t is volume of the element, so we can write the net force in the x direction from the stresses in the normal stresses in the x direction are nothing but delta sigma x into delta v, wherein delta v is nothing but delta x into delta y into t. Now, the other component which is going to come from this stress acting on this area, whose magnitude is delta x into t, and similarly this stress y x is also acting on the similar area. So, therefore, the net force is nothing but this incremental stress multiplied by the area delta x into t. So, therefore, the net force is going to be again delta tau y x delta y multiplied by delta y into delta x into t. And if we represent again delta x into delta y into t as delta v, then we will have it as delta tau y x delta y multiplied by delta v. Then this force, which is also contributing to the stress, to the force in the x direction, which is nothing but x into delta v. So, therefore, we will have x into delta v, that is the force in the x direction. So, therefore, sum of all these things must be equal to 0. So, delta v is a common quantity. Finally, we can write the equation as delta sigma x plus delta tau yx delta y plus x equal to 0. So, this is the equilibrium equation in the x direction. Now, we would like to also consider the equilibrium in the y direction. So, if we now consider in a similar manner summation of the forces in the y direction equal to 0, that will give us like this. You have the force coming out in this y direction is due to this normal stress, and due to this shear stress and this shear stress, plus component due to the body force y. Now, the differential force acting in the y direction due to the normal stress is going to be this magnitude multiplied by the area, which is delta x into t. And therefore, again we can write delta x delta y into t as delta v. So, therefore, the differential force is nothing but this delta sigma y delta y multiplied by delta v. So, delta sigma y delta y multiplied by v. And from the shear stress tau x y plus delta tau x y delta x, and this tau x y acting here, the area of this face is nothing but delta y into t. So, therefore, the differential force is going to be simply due to this multiplied by the area is delta y t. The component would be delta tau x y delta x into delta v. So, therefore, again this is going to be delta tau xy delta ax multiplied by delta v plus the component due to y is nothing but y into delta v. So, therefore, this is y into delta v is equal to 0. So, we can now take the common factor out, and therefore, our second equilibrium equation is delta tau xy delta x plus delta sigma y delta y plus y equal to 0. Now, we will consider, let us say that the center point here of the element is O. Now, this element must also be in moment equilibrium, and therefore, if we write moment of all the forces above the center point O equal to 0, let us see what are the forces that is going to cause moment. Since this stress is going to be uniformly acting over this area, or let me put it this way, that we are considering this distance delta y is so very small that this stress intensity can be taken to be uniform over this area. Similarly, for all other stresses, we can take them to be uniform over the faces over which they are acting. Therefore, the resultant of the force due to this stress will pass through this point, so also due to this will pass through this point, and by similar consideration, resultant force due to this stress and this stress will pass through this point. So, therefore, the moment, and again x and y are going to pass through this point. So, therefore, the moment will be caused by these two shear stresses in the anticlockwise direction, these two shear stresses in the clockwise direction. Now, if we try to consider the moment due to these two shear stresses in the anticlockwise direction, it is nothing but we will have this delta tau xy working on an area of magnitude delta y into t, and they are separated at a distance of delta x. So, therefore, our moment magnitude is going to be nothing but it is tau xy acting on an area of delta y into t, and these two stresses are at a distance of delta x. So, that is the moment due to this and this component. Now, if I consider this, it is acting on an area of delta y t, and it is acting at a distance of delta x. So, therefore, we will have a component like delta tau xy delta x into delta x, and it is acting over an area of delta y into t, and the moment term is delta x by 2. So, therefore, this is delta x by 2, that is the anticlockwise moment. Now, if we go for similar reasoning for this component tau y x and tau y x plus delta tau y x delta y into delta y, this tau y x will give us moment, which is nothing but tau y x multiplied by delta x into t multiplied by delta y. So, therefore, that moment is going to be in the clockwise direction. So, we can write now, we can write that tau y x, it is acting over an area of delta x into t, and the moment term is delta y minus the moment due to this is going to be delta tau y x delta y into delta y multiplied by delta x into t, and the moment term is delta y by 2. So, therefore, we will have delta tau y x delta y multiplied by delta y, and the area is delta x into t, and the moment arm is delta y by 2. So, these are the two constituents. So, this is in the clock anticlockwise direction, this moment is in the clockwise direction. So, therefore, they must add up to 0. Now, we are trying to talk about a distance delta x, delta y very small. So, since delta x is very small and so also delta y, therefore, we will find that these terms are going, if we just remove the delta x delta y into t terms, this term is going to be left with delta x by 2 and this term is going to be left with delta y by 2, and we can neglect them. So, finally, what we find is that we will have tau x y minus tau y x is equal to 0. Therefore, tau x y is equal to tau y x. So, this is the, so let us name this as the second equilibrium equation and this is the third equilibrium equation. So, therefore, we have three equilibrium equations in two dimensions. These are the three equilibrium equations in two dimensional rectangular polar coordinates. This one is the equilibrium in the x direction, this is equilibrium in the y direction, and this is the moment equilibrium equation. Now, one important thing you must appreciate that the stresses at a point are such that the tau x y stress is acting on the face which is perpendicular to the x direction, tau y x is the stress acting on the face perpendicular to the y directions. These two stresses are acting on two orthogonal planes and they are always going to be equal. So, that is why sometimes we call this tau y x to be complementary to tau x y. Whenever this is present, this stress is also present, and obviously this stress is always present along with this. So, whenever this stress is present, we are also going to have this stress present. So, these complementary stresses are equal. So, without further discussion, we can always assume that tau x y to be equal to tau y x, and that ensures moment equilibrium. Now, these three equilibrium equations, if we make use of the tensor notation, it becomes again compact. So, particularly this equation 1 and 2, we can write like this, sigma I j comma j plus x I equal to 0, where I takes up value 1 to 2, so also j takes up value 1 to 2. So, when you have I equal to 1 and this comma indicates derivative of this component with respect to j. So, therefore, it will give us two components, and this, since they are repeated, there is summation involved, and therefore, it gives you the equation 1 and 2. So, this is also sometimes sometimes called the equilibrium equations in two dimensions. Obviously, we can have the extension in three dimensions very easily, then in that case we are going to have the same form, but we are going to have values of I varying from 1 to 3, so j taking up values 1, 2, 3. So, I leave it as an exercise for you to determine the equilibrium equations in three dimensions. So, to summarize, what we have done in this lecture is that we have considered first of all the transformation of strains. Strain is a tensor like a stress tensor, and whatever rules applies to transformation of stress can be used for the transformation of strains. So, we have written the expression for strain transformation from one system to another system. So, in the new system epsilon m n is nothing but epsilon m I epsilon n j multiplied by epsilon I j, where this is new and this is old set, and these are the direction cosines of the new set. Then we have tried to consider definition of strains in polar coordinates, and we have found that epsilon r is equal to partial derivative of the radial displacement u with respect to r, that is the strain in the radial direction, and the strain in the circumferential direction, it was nothing but u by r plus 1 by r delta v delta theta. And similarly, we had also derived gamma r theta, which is nothing but 1 by r delta u delta theta plus delta v delta r minus v by r. Now, I would like you to note one situation, that there is a possibility that we may have displacements taking place only in the radial direction. Think of the case, that you have a hollow cylinder and it is pressurized by internal pressure. Under the action of this internal pressure, the points are going to move only in the radial direction. The geometry of the body will not get distorted, and it is simply going to expand, and therefore, each point is going to just have a displacement in the radial direction. You will not find any displacement in the tangential direction here. So, v is equal to 0, and this u is going to be only dependent on the radial distance of the point, and therefore, this u is a function of r alone. So, in this particular case, u is a function of r alone and v is 0, and therefore, in this case, what are going to be the strains? You will find that here epsilon r is just going to be delta u delta r, and since r is a, u is a function of r alone, so we can write this thing as du dr, total derivative rather than partial derivative. And epsilon theta is going to be nothing but, since v is not present, so therefore, this part is 0 and the tangential strain is u by r, and shear strain gamma r theta, herein u is not a function of theta, so therefore, this is going to be 0, v is not present, so therefore, this is 0 and v is 0, so therefore, everything is 0, so therefore, there is no shear strain. So, what we find is that in this case, there is no shear deformation of the body, and this is also clear from the changed configuration of the body. In this case, it is simply going to maintain the radial symmetry or symmetry about the axis. So, therefore, it is not going to have any change of angle between the radial and tangential directions. What I mean is that, if you have a circle initially like this, the angle between the radial direction and tangential direction is 90 degree, and once it gets displaced to a position like this, the angle between the radial direction and tangential direction is again 90 degree. So, therefore, there is no shear deformation here. So, therefore, in this case, obviously, the angle 90 degree is maintained, and therefore, the shear strain is 0 there, and this is a typical case wherein you have only radial displacements. Then we have considered, of course, the equilibrium equations in 2D rectangular coordinates. And those equilibrium equations we have written in the form xij comma j plus xi equal to 0.